asked why, they did not make any actions. One episode shows a woman needing to fill a prescription at a pharmacy. She doesn't quite have the money to pay for it, so other customers are sitting and watching in the waiting room or in the waiting area of the store are just wanting to know what's going to happen. A couple of people offer the woman the money she needs, but a few read or get up and walk away, waiting and hoping that she'll be leaving soon. When a person seems to have done what is expected, there are smiles all around, but that's not always the case. Another episode depicts an atheist who is eating in a restaurant. This person becomes angry and vocal when a Christian family sits next to him and starts praying before they eat their meal. The Christian family ignores the atheist's comments, but what happens is, upon completing their prayer, the atheist then wants to talk with one of the parents about how they should not be doing this in a public place, and how they're actually harming their children, saying to them that God exists. What would you do? Pentecost is now. God's Spirit is amongst us, and we're called to rejoice that God is faithful, that God blesses us, and that His Spirit will lead and guide us every day of our living. But all of these actions are from God to us. The question we need to answer is, how do we respond to all of these actions that God has and does for us? God is faithful, blessing us and leading and guiding us. But what do many of us do? Sometimes we ignore the Spirit speaking to us. We walk away, or we just don't want to be doing what the Spirit wants us to do. But if we say we are followers of God in faith, that we let the Spirit guide us as we are truly living the way of God, how do we respond? Most of us have cell phones, or you have telephones at home. Some of those phone lines, you have an option built in or you pay for, call display. Maybe you know what I mean by call display. This is the way that you can figure out who's calling you by recognizing the name or the number as it appears on the screen or on the phone itself. On cell phones, there are two boxes which are colored red or green, depending on your make and your model. This is all I'm learning about technology. To answer, green is step. Or red, stop, that is, and you can answer or decline the call. On other phones, it might say the individual's name or company name, then the phone number. And what occurs in both situations, whatever kind of phone it is up to the person who is receiving the call. Do you accept it? Do you not answer it? Or do you let the machine pick up? What if you accept the call, knowing who it is? It could be a two-minute call, or it could be 30 minutes, depending on who it is. You might not even recognize the name or the number. I know that we've been getting political calls lately. That's all I'm going to say now. People wanting to know who you're going to vote for. Don't know the numbers, don't know who it is, but you answer anyway. Or do you? Not to mention all the telemarketers that are out there. You don't know whether it's your telemarketer or whether it's someone you know and love and needs you right away. Or it could be a doctor's receptionist or your bank. Before call display was made possible, the shock of it all, you didn't know who it was on the other end. Do you remember that? Who's calling? I don't know who's calling. Until you answer it. We risked it all. You answered the phone. You risked it all, time included. Hello. And then began a conversation. Well, today we don't receive phone calls as often, for many times our messages can be summed up by texting, by tweeting, or even an email. And we do those when it's most convenient, when we choose, when another person is wanting us or not wanting us. But is this what we should or ought to do or not? By choosing not to respond, what are we missing? This is also true in the Spirit calling you to live according to Jesus' teachings and out of love that you have for God. Why do we serve God? For many you can be recognized. And as he goes up to the first tee, tees up that first ball, an angel looks down from heaven, says, "Arapa, I play golf on the Sabbath." And the angel goes and tells God. God was upset. On the third hole, this poor rabbi sat down. God sent down a gust of wind, and as that rabbi was going to hit that drive, a gust of wind went, and the ball went into the cup. A home run. The angel watching this said to God, "You call that punishment?" "Think about it," God replied. "Who can you tell?" It's the Sabbath. Who can you tell? In our gospel readings, the Pharisees are taking close watch on Jesus and what he and the disciples are doing. They notice that he and his disciples took some grain from a field in order to make some fruit. The Pharisees accuse Jesus of doing unlawful things on the Sabbath, the holy day of rest. But then Jesus tells them the story about David from the Old Testament stories, or their Hebrew, or their Torah, about one time when David was with his hungry friends, and they go in to see the priest in the synagogue and say, "We're really, really hungry." And what does the priest do? He gives them the consecrated food, the food that's set aside for the priest. Was the high priest at fault and wrong? Yes, because he broke the law that the food was only supposed to be eaten by the priest. But in this story, David gets to eat. The Pharisees claimed that this was wrong, they shouldn't have been able to have that. But Jesus says, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. The Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. And then when Jesus goes to the synagogue another day, a man with a shriveled hand comes in, and the people are watching Jesus, and anything he said or did was being reported back to the Pharisees. Jesus sees that man and says, "Stand up." Tells that man to stand up. He turns to the crowd, which is lawful, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill on the Sabbath. No one said a word. What would you have done? Nothing? Answer the question, or say, "Go ahead, heal that man's hand," and then face the consequences of the people in the synagogue? And the Pharisees, or the teachers of the law, risk being booted out of the synagogue and the community? What would you have done? Risk. When you answer your call to serve God, you risk and you continue to risk a lot of things, your life, your credibility, and mostly you risk who you once were in order to become in our time. If we see someone in need, we would not hesitate to call 911. Get emergency help, whatever that is, because we know that this is what is necessary. Yet back then, to go against the Pharisees meant possibly being excluded from that community, from that synagogue, and anyone who supported them. You've been banished. You've been left out and left alone. But Jesus said, "Stretch out your hand." He stretches it out, that man stretches it out, and his hand is completely restored. The people are in awe and wonder, but no one says anything. The Pharisees who are watching get up and leave. The text then says that they began to plot with the Herodians about how they might get rid of Jesus, that is, kill him. The Pharisees deny Jesus, question their teachings, their policies, their laws, including those made about the Sabbath and what healing really meant. Often, when we think of healing, we instinctively acknowledge the need for physical healing, because that is what is seen. More and more stories are shared now about the need for mental health or healing. But Jesus, through the healing of this man's hand, also raised the need for spiritual healing, to be made whole in Christ's presence. How often do we think of spiritual healing? And if we do, is it all right to ask for spiritual healing on the Sabbath? These are some of the questions we
Loving God, here we are ready to listen, to work, and to do what you make us to do. Help us to respond in faith, with hope, and to truly love others in Jesus' name, so that we might speak up and show others about how much you truly love us and care for all of our children in faith. We ask this in Jesus' name.